In a world filled with war, hate, suffering, and Justin Bieber, two guys fix it all with a battle about a movie. One film, two opinions, one coin, two sides. They feud. You decide. It's time for Film Feud.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Film Feud, the podcast where we debate whether top-rated movies should be top-rated. I'm Vidur.
And I'm Vikram.
And Vikram, why don't you tell the good folk what we do here?
No. Please. So what we do is pick a movie from the IMDb top 250 at random, and we toss a coin, and heads argues for and tails argues against.
Simple enough. And the movie we're arguing this week is...
Oh, that's a cue for me. The Green Mile.
The Green Mile. And I am struck by the fact that probably nobody has ever feuded over the Green Mile on like some digital media platform. All these movie podcasts and...
It's before the internet age. Actually, a lot of movies are. That's a stupid point. But this movie is actually
we
very...
We feuded 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Oh, yeah. But I mean, that's like an epic movie, right? This one, I feel, is actually very feudable, if you think about it.
This movie might be an epic movie. It just depends how the coin toss goes. Yeah. So just to clarify, I have not watched this movie because... It seemed really weird and boring. And all I remember is a lot of moths coming out of Clark Duncan. Who is, unfortunately, rest in peace. All I remember is they come out of his mouth.
Right. It was. I think it was in the... it released when you were still in your Bollywood phase. It's like Govinda was ruling your life. So, I, on the other hand, have seen the movie. I've only seen it once, though. And I'm sure it was around... when I was in the 9th or the 10th grade, was coming on TV or something. I have flashes of this movie, but I'm pretty unclear about the major events. So a rewatch will be interesting. And the movies, I mean, it's... I don't want to play my cards right now. It's too premature.
Impressively neutral commentary from Vikram.
I'm getting really good at this.
All right, let's do it. Let's toss this coin and figure out the sides. We're going to be feuding.
So I will be tossing the coin. And if I get heads, I'm arguing for and tails against. Here we go. I have got heads and I'm actually pretty happy about that.
I am pretty happy to... It can't be too good if I missed it.
Oh, right.
Somebody would have been like, hey, man.
Because Raging Bull and like I know, like, I have a list of these movies, by the way.
Can we just go through one episode where you don't bring up the fact that I haven't seen Raging
Bull?
Just don't
use that argument then.
I have not watched Raging Bull, but that's just by choice. This movie, if it was good, I would have watched it.
Dude, come on. I'll give you another chance. Come up with another argument for that one.
I have not watched Raging Bull because Robert De Niro is not a good actor. But Michael Clark Duncan is definitely not a good actor. Otherwise, I'd have heard something.
Right.
Didn't he get nominated for this?
He got nominated for an Oscar for this one.
What do the Oscars know, dude?
Yeah, I know. And Tommy Hanks, just like one of those actors.
Tommy Hanks, Ham Tonks.
Yeah. I mean, this...
Consistently boring. The most vanilla actor. He's like, if you go to Baskin Robbins and you have vanilla, that's like choosing to watch a Tom Hanks movie. Name one non-boring Tom Hanks movie.
Forrest Gump.
Ugh, vanilla.
Philadelphia.
Ugh, haven't seen it.
Saving Private Ryan. Haven't seen Philadelphia. Haven't seen Saving Private Ryan.
I have seen Saving Private Ryan. And he wasn't Private Ryan. It was so disappointing.
Right. Good point. Fair point. Anyways, I'm not arguing about Tom Hanks. I think as he gets older, he actually gets better and better. Look at the movies he's doing now.
Like,
have you seen Have you seen The Post?
Like The Circle, the biggest bomb of 2017.
Yeah, all right. You picked the one movie out of the 20
And stop
great
dating
ones.
This podcast, okay? Our podcast is to be listened till the end of listened.
The Post, the Post came out 2.5 years ago.
Yeah, we are recording this when Trump is about to get reelected.
too much.
Can we move on to watching the movie? I am really not excited, so let's just get this over with.
I am pretty stoked. I'm glad I got four because then I'm just going to watch this movie without any prejudice in mind, and I'm actually going to enjoy it. I know it already.
You're boring me more than this movie is going to bore me. No prejudice intended, but I just have a feeling.
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do it. Let's go watch the movie. That was torture.
Can you be more predictable? If this is torture, capture terrorists have the best life possible.
Let's not get political. That was... I'm going to say something to you no one's ever said before.
Bring it.
It's so long. Why is it so long? I knew it. It's basically Shawshank Redemption Part 2. This slow burn of Frank Darabont adapting a Stephen King novel. Oh my God, he didn't need to adapt every page, dude.
Dude, I think length is actually one of the better facets of this movie. Very honestly speaking, before you come up with a stupid rebuttal to that.
I think length doesn't matter.
That's size.
Oh.
The length of this movie, I think I've spoken to a lot of people also. Who I remember talking to them, and like whenever we spoke about Green Mile or you know, things about Green Mile, the biggest gripe that people generally have is length. I actually think the length is one of the better parts of this movie because it allows to show life in a prison. It has a lot of character development of the guards and the inmates, their specific executions, which, by the way, are shown in a manner which is grotesque but so real.
Horrendous.
I loved it.
Scary, exorcist level.
And coming back to the length, most importantly, Tom Hanks's guilt in allowing Coffee to be executed. All these things in a movie of like a standard 120, 130 minute runtime would have been wasted or rushed or simply just taken out, and it'll just take away from the movie. I love the length of this movie.
What an insult to editors everywhere.
Insult.
You're stupid, like, oh, this length is the perfect length. Of course, how predictable, just because you're for the movie, you think this ridiculously long movie is the perfect length.
No, wait, that's not an insult to editors. It's an editor's job to edit the movie, but it's eventually the director's job to pick the best movie that he could make.
Who was the editor of this movie? My guess is no one.
Imagine if they shot like 4.5 hours worth of footage or something like that. I don't think this is
like the Batman versus Superman director's cut, and they just released it just like that. They should have come out with a cinematic cut.
No, man, director's cut was way better.
And I know you're going to defend it, but they could have cut the whole where they go to fix his wife and shit. They could have easily cut that part of the movie.
Why?
What do you mean, why?
What part did you think was required cuts in that scene or that entire sequence?
Actually, forget that scene. You know what part they really could have cut is the Saving Private Ryan structure of like showing the old man at the start and the finish. I know they needed like that magical realism.
The guy's 108
punchline.
Years old. That revelation would not have been effective if this wasn't a thing, like the intro and the outro.
Firstly, it could have been just the outro instead of the intro. Although I must say my biggest takeaway from the intro is that like old age homes, people still have girlfriends and shit.
Why not, man?
That's awesome, dude. I'm actually
looking
forward to this.
It's like emotional partners, dude.
That was probably my biggest takeaway from the movie. The undercurrent, the underlying theme that I gathered.
When you grow old, like, there's still scope.
There's still scope. You can still get some. I actually got so bored during this movie that I wrote a poem summarizing the movie.
Oh my God. I cannot wait.
We can go through the movie.
No, I want to listen to the poem right now.
I'm not willing to just give it
please,
in one go.
Please.
I'm going to drip it out.
You're going to like go sentence by sentence?
We're going to go act by act in the movie.
Whatever, man. You want to lay it on me right now or in parts? I'm all for it. I'm so excited to hear it. Genuinely excited.
All right, let's just kick it off with the first stanza, are they called? I was going to say para.
You have stanzas in your poem?
There once was a man named Edgecomb, who met a dude built like a tower.
Okay.
He had muscles and a big dome.
Okay.
And an ambiguous superpower.
That's...
I'm not done. The last line of the stanza is...
Oh, it's like one of those.
Oh, and he was black.
Still, it doesn't have a positive or a negative connotation of...
The power was super ambiguous. I'm not saying I have a positive or negative connotation. Let the length and dragness of the movie wash over me before I came to a conclusion of how much it sucked.
Okay.
That superpower is so ambiguous, bro. Kuch bhi ho raha
hai. It was. And it wasn't meant to be explained in its actuality. That wasn't the point of the movie. The point of the movie that was there and what effects it had and what ramifications it had to the people in the set, if you must say. So I'm not peeved at all. You know, usually I would be if some things in the story are left vague and stuff like that. But I'm actually kind of glad that they didn't try to provide an explanation for that, because they wouldn't have done a good job at it. No one can, idly, and I'm kind of glad that they didn't.
No, I get it. The whole magical realism element of it. You know, it's not like I wasn't on board for it. They'd execute it perfectly. Although I do believe it got a lot of hate because it was a black dude and he's magic and it's like this Jesus analogy.
Spike Lee lost it, dude.
Yeah, I heard that Spike Lee lost it, which I will bring up soon, shortly. Wow,
how is that a gripe for you? It's Spike Lee.
I don't think it was good storytelling at all. Firstly, he used the same twist as Shawshank Redemption. That Sam Rockwell, who comes to the same jail, is actually the guy who committed the real crime that the protagonist is accused of. Or not protagonist, in this case, John Coffey. And also, John Coffey's not saying anything. It was so dumb. The storytelling ended up being pretty hacky, man. Other elements of it too, you know, somewhat predictable. I guess maybe in the 90s, this counted as interesting structure, or it was actually supposedly appeasing to audiences. But, oh, you know how he always wanted to go to Brian Ridge, the mental asylum. And in the end, he went as a patient, not as a guard. Ooh, yuck, 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 yuck. So dumb.
Yuck, 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 yuck. Can you please clarify that one for me? It's like you saying yuck in a sing-song way, or like, is that like a thing about...
No, I mean like, oh, it's the comeuppance, so it's like the release of the audience, so it's like something, look at that.
You're the aha moment.
Ha, ha, ha.
I don't know, man. Just the fact that you say saying stuff like how it's so similar to The Shawshank in terms of white guy, black guy, same criminal, yada, 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 just makes me understand or realize that you did not grasp this movie in the essence that it's supposed to be.
Ooh, enlighten me why doth you don't.
Why doth I don't, I shan't. Is that... No? No, I tried. This movie is a f***ing masterpiece. Just the way Darabont shot this movie blew me away. The shots, the slow zoom-ins to the prison guard sitting on the table. Mr. Jingles, man. He made me love a rat, a mouse, whatever that was. He made me fall in love with a character which doesn't say anything, just rolls a roll of wood around, and I fell in love with it. And each and every character in this movie held up. Each and every character, each and every actor in this movie killed it. There was no bad performance in this movie at all, even though the cast was maybe 10 or 12 people at most. So there's so much else to this movie apart from what the story was and what it tried to portray.
I will grant you both things you said. Surprisingly, we're getting over with the granting in one go. I will grant you the performances. I personally enjoyed Sam Rockwell the most. I think Hom Tanks was just what he is usually.
Homie Tanks?
Homie Tanks is just, you know, he's just Homie Tanks, basically. He's just Homie Tanks with a urinary tract infection in this one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Sam Rockwell was my personal favorite in terms of performances.
Was it? I actually like the smaller characters. The guy who played Dell, Michael Jeter.
Yeah.
He was phenomenal. Harry Dean Stanton, the janitor, dude. The guy who used to practice the executions with. I thought he was there for like all of 3 minutes in a movie of 3 hours and killed it.
Yeah, he was good. I mean, the performances were great. That scene was good.
Percy, the messed up warden as well, Doug Hutchinson. I think he was pretty good too.
Yeah. Yeah, and I grant the performances. I think they wasted on this movie, but I grant them.
And I also grant the put that one in.
And I also grant the other thing you said. Mr. Jingles killed it. Best performance by far.
You know, they use like 10 to 15 rats.
I knew it. I didn't know that, but I knew
that
would be the
case. And a combination of CGI. So the scene where Percy stomps Mr. Jingles is actually CGI, thankfully.
Obviously, because it's not allowed. You can't even like stomp a cricket on set. It's like the Peter or whatever goes crazy. As they should, I suppose.
Whatever.
I don't know.
Crickets.
Somebody's got to look out for the crickets.
What about mosquitoes? I've asked this, a friend of mine who's in animal welfare. I've asked him this question many times. What does PETA feel about killing mosquitoes?
Mosquitoes don't have nervous systems, so I don't think it should be a big deal.
So nervous system is the criteria for killing an animal?
I think that is reasonable. It's a whole different podcast, by the way.
Yeah.
I do know that PETA was standing by when Jonah Hill was swallowing the goldfish in Wolf of Wall Street.
Right.
And so he needed to swallow it and spit it back out into water every time. He wasn't allowed to like kill it or actually.
And knowing Scorsese, those must have been multiple takes.
Oh, of course. He swallowed like 50. I mean, the same goldfish like 50 times probably.
Yeah. So good to know that no rats were harmed during the production of this movie.
Yeah, they had to say that right at the start.
Oh, they did?
No, I'm kidding.
I didn't miss that one.
That scene with Harry Dean Stanton, by the way, which I did like the execution practice. It took me a while to understand what's happening because I thought he was actually some guy who was getting executed.
Right.
And then I realized, like, again, coming back to the hacky storytelling, I knew the scene would be relevant. I knew the way they did the sponge. Like, to me, that was like Chekhov's sponge. You know, like, you know it's just going to go act up and shoot someone, like, the gun eventually at some point in the movie. It just made everything so predictable. I don't know. Maybe Maybe it's not meant for like sophisticated
audiences. It's not a thriller, man.
It's not a thriller.
It's not supposed to be an unpredictable movie. It's supposed to be a movie which shows a passage of time from X point to Y point and what happens.
Then it's about, I guess it's addressing unsophisticated audiences then. Like all this kind of stuff.
Jesus, can you be more highbrow?
That's just who I am, man. What can I do? I just think if you make a movie predictable in parts, then that should take away from the movie, which I think it does. And even Shawshank Redemption didn't have... I mean, the main twist in Shawshank Redemption wasn't even predictable.
They're made by the same director and the book's written by the same author. Doesn't mean that the same movies, just because they're set in a prison...
How can you...
They're They're two completely different stories set in the same or similar environment,
which
is a prison.
With the same twist.
How is it a same twist?
That the guy who did it ends up in the same prison and...
That's one of the plot twists. That's not so the plot. The twist... There's no twist in this movie, essentially. That's what it is, right? It's about Tom Hanks's realization, what Michael Clark Duncan's effect has on the entire Green Mile prison cell or prison system block or whatever. What effect it has on all of the prisoners, what effect it has on all of the guards, how their lives change. It's not a twist movie.
Which brings me to the second stanza.
Okay. Wait, before we get into this, how many do you have? I just want to know.
Four.
You have four stanzas? Okay, let's hear it.
Putting someone to death is tricky. They could have just used a rope. He won over the jailer by fixing his dickie. Spike Lee said it was a magic Negro trope. Oh, and no one cared.
Funniest part about that stanza is you said dickie. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. What's going on, man?
You think the executioner or the capital punishment should have been death by hanging?
I don't know. Whatever it was, that exorcist level horrifying scene of Percy screwing over Del's execution, that was brutal, man.
It was. It kind of was brutal. And I honestly won't be surprised if that's what actually happens if you do that, if you don't want this much.
Do you know on a rope, you don't hang by, you don't die because of lack of oxygen.
You die because of the jhatka, the...
Your neck snaps.
Yeah, your neck snaps.
That doesn't sound good either.
There was some movie, side note, but some movie or some TV show where some dude tried to hang himself, but his neck muscles were so thick that his neck didn't snap.
Jesus.
And he's just hanging there. It's
like some one of those old wives, like Rajput tales, they tried to hang Rana Pratap.
Yeah, hang...
And he eventually suffocated, choked himself to death. With his own hands.
Because he wasn't dying. And he wanted the honorable death. Yeah, dude. Hanging's... whatever. I mean, let's not talk about that. But
no, I get it. It was kind of cool to show how brutal the death penalty and, you
and
know,
just
the
scene,
really is.
The scene running up to it when they're talking and when the guards themselves are... Firstly, I loved how they showed that all of the guards except for Percy were actually humane people.
Mm-hmm.
And as opposed to... I don't know what my mindset or my assumption of 1935 is. Post-prohibition and like the stock market crash and stuff like that. So I had a different outlook.
That part was cool because that's why a job was so important, right?
Right.
It's the be-all and end-all,
right?
A job. And why you could work, like they were willing to work anywhere, basically.
And the way, not just Tom Hanks, but all of the guards, except for Percy, obviously, just like, they're very comforting to the prisoners there. Like they set up a thing for Del before his execution so that they could do the practice run and stuff like that. And like talking about Mouseville or wherever Mr. Jingles would go to. And just their how affected they were when the Del thing happened or any other execution happened, how solemn they were when the Harry Dean Stanton practice run was happening and they broke out into a laugh, and then how they all just got back to it and understood the seriousness of it. I loved how they show all of these guys are really, really humane, and I was pleasantly surprised, man. And if, obviously, I'm not saying this is an accurate depiction of what 1935 mindset was, but I mean, I didn't mind this at all. It didn't at any point feel like, oh, this movie cannot be 1935. Because there are a lot of movies where the way they talk, it just becomes modern. They start using modern words or something like that.
All right, man. It's not like some Chomo making a movie. It's fine. I expect Frank Darabont to be able to stick to a period drama.
We've seen people mess it up as well.
Yeah, but this is the post Shawshank Redemption high budget movie. It's fine. They'll get all that right. I don't give that much credit. I guess the look of it was okay. It's also very easy to make a period drama if it's in basically one set. That makes it a lot easier. It's not like they're trying to make...
It's like they show houses, they show cars, they show a lot of stuff. It's not just... I mean, the main set is obviously the Green Mile, but there's so much other stuff that went into place as well.
It was meant to be like a Shawshank type emotional journey, and this, I don't need to keep bringing it up, honestly. It's just it's such an obvious comparison, especially because both movies are so long and, you know, they try to show the same environment. it took you on this emotional journey, but I just think it was mellow in every spot. And I honestly did not like that side plot of the warden's wife. I don't think it added too much. It just kind of went overboard with it and we got it. And then the Michael Clarke Duncan performance, while suitable, I suppose, to the movie, I don't get why he was nominated. I don't get why this movie was so lauded by the Academy Awards. That's crazy to me.
I loved his performance, man.
Crying and sad and weird all the time.
We'll talk about it, but I just want to backtrack and talk about the warden's wife side plot. It's super important because that defines the ending of the movie, right? It shows that he cures the warden's wife, but and he's shown as this all good being who wants, like, he's seen bad in the world and he wants, like, he feels the pain all the time, like a very, well, clearly a very Jesus Christ sort of a thing. But
JC, good old JC.
JC, John Coffee. Coffee spelled differently or whatever. And he actually ends up doing a bad deed because he wants to actually punish bad guys. So he punishes two bad guys, the two main bad guys of the movie, in one go. So that couldn't have arisen. That entire tangent to the movie or John Coffey's psyche couldn't have come up if he hadn't cured the wife.
Quite the punishment, by the way. Jeez.
Dude, all right. Apart from John Coffey, if you see a movie and you see just inhuman, and especially after John Coffey finds out that Sam Rockwell's the person who killed and raped those two girls, and that's the reason. I mean, Coffey being in prison, I don't think Coffey would care enough, but just the fact that Wild Bill did that deed, and of course what Percy did to Del as well, because John kept saying, I felt it. None of that wouldn't have arisen if he wouldn't have cured the warden's wife. So I think it was actually a pretty important tangent to the movie, and it showed a lot of, well, it built Michael Clarke Duncan's character to the next level. Up until then, he was just acting as this vague figure with a vague superpower. He was just trying to do good.
Vague.
It's vague. Obviously, it's vague. It's not defined at all. It's completely undefined, but you get a good sense of what it is. And he's trying to do it throughout the entire movie. And up until that point, he's the do-all, good-all, whatever. He's going to get executed eventually and stuff. And then he just pulls that stunt. Completely changed the tone of the movie for me.
I guess it did. I'm not saying it didn't, but it wasn't for the better. It just kind of left me kind of confused about what his character, his motivations, his role really was in the movie. I mean, he wanted to punish him. I get it. He did the bad thing. But take it easy, man. You don't need to drive this person insane, you know? Just teach him a lesson. There's no coming back from that shit.
It's not like he can do anything. He can only do specific things.
He can do anything. What a weird power, though. The one he gave Paul Edgecombe and Mr. Jingles in the end.
Uh-huh.
You live forever, but keep getting older and older. So this guy, like Paul Edgecombe, will just be like 196, just a barrel of bones and saggy flesh, a brain in a
mat. No, I mean, it's safe to say, if he's 108 and he looks like that actor who played him is actually, he was 83 when he shot for that movie. If you look 83 when you're 108, when you're 196, you look 100.
No, you look 176.
Dude, a side note, there's such an interesting Reddit thread about how old Paul Edgecombe will be when he dies. Super interesting.
Yeah, they extrapolate from the mouse.
Crazy
that
theories.
Far, right?
Just like theory on theory. Like,
it's going to be 1,000 years old, dude. He's going to be living like this futuristic city. Hanging, but he can't move. He's so fucking old, but his brain is still alive.
Read that Reddit thread. There's this one thing about units of magic that Michael Clarke Duncan gave to the mouse and to Paul Edgecombe.
You're making my argument for me here.
They use math. These guys on Reddit use math. But it's really interesting.
It should be units of curse. This is a curse. It's like being Logan without the healing factor. You just get shot and it just stays in you, but you can't die.
It's his curse. It's a power and a curse. He says so himself. And it's, I don't know, man. I don't know. You're like holding on to like the things that don't matter and like missing out on the things that do.
This brings me to the third stanza.
Bring it.
Because we've reached the point where Michael Clarke Duncan serves his role and he's offed.
Oh, best scene of the movie.
What scene?
His execution.
Yeah, it's so sad. Oh,
it
my
is.
God.
Not just sad, man. And his realization, he's like, oh, I've seen the bad in the world. I've seen a glimpse.
Excuse me. I was in the middle of reciting the third stanza.
Sorry, sir. Sorry, good sir.
This one's really simplistic, okay?
Please comments.
I want to bring audiences in. I don't want to be as sophisticated as the movie's trying to be and failing at. He didn't mind dying if he could just watch a movie. He started crying and everything was groovy. Oh, and he was innocent and tired or something like that. That's part of the poem, by the way.
Of course. The fifth line.
Yeah.
I haven't forgotten. By far the weakest stanza in your poem.
I know. I kind of gave up because the movie
is the fourth
also
going to be weaker? Because if it is, then just don't.
It just mirrors the movie. just consistently gets lamer and lamer.
I don't know, man. I loved the last scene and that entire run up to that.
I just want to clarify before you go on.
Of course, please.
Sorry to interrupt.
No worries, no worries. Good, sir.
My fourth stanza is the strongest.
Is it?
Yeah.
Why don't you just lay it on me right now?
Just be prepared.
Why don't you just lay it on me?
Okay.
What are you waiting for?
I will. You know. Don't think I won't.
Bitch.
The first line you have to focus on is very smart.
Oh my God. Do I need like Google or something?
Ready?
Steady?
Yeah. He kept both Tom and Jerry alive. But they killed him anyway. The 108-year-old had a girlfriend and a sex drive. It's a Jesus analogy. Come on, let's pray. Amen.
Just because two old people are talking to each other, automatically they're banging.
They're banging, bro.
But
I'm not
going to dignify
had
that.
Had a broad, had a little man cave. Eventually, their casual relationship started getting a little serious.
No.
And she's like, where do you go on walks? And he's like, oh man, I gotta show him my man cave and also my weird mouse fetish. So he just made up this whole story. And also, everybody likes to look younger than they are. So he's just like, oh, by the way, I know I look all saggy and 83, you know, but actually I'm 108. I look pretty good for 108. It's the same way I tell people I'm 38. They're like, I look pretty good for 38.
Not gonna dignify this with a discussion. What I liked about that stanza was your wordplay on Tom and Jerry. Kudos, sir.
Ah, kudos. You noticed.
I did. That was actually pretty good. But since the poem's over with, I'm kind of relieved. That third stanza.
Just how I felt the when the movie stanza got done. The mirroring is genius, dude. They should call me Vidur Burns.
Easy, brother. Easy. Rein it in. But I don't know, man. I think the last leg of the movie, especially the last 10 or 15 minutes where Tom Hanks is super conflicted about whether he should tell the warden that coffee's innocent or not, then his wife telling him, Bonnie Hunt, by the way. I mean, every actor in this movie kills it. I think they're really, really good. And her telling him if the warden can't do anything, then don't tell him. He has to live with it. Then he decides not to. And then Coffey's last few words about how he's seen the bad. Now he's seen the good. He just wants to go. Don't put the thing on my head. Oh my God, dude, this movie's so good. What's wrong with you?
I haven't said this yet, but there is this part of me that wants to say that this movie made me want to put myself in the electric chair. And wow. I just never went there.
Wow.
I thought it would be too insensitive.
Right. Politically incorrect.
Yeah. I'm very much against the death penalty, though. Are you? Should we close this out on like a purely serious note?
Sure.
We should rehabilitate as much as we can. Surely the death penalty is not the answer.
I agree. But that being said, the rehabilitation system, I mean, I know the states, for example, doesn't have death penalty in all of the states. It just has it in a few, and in a few it's like life imprisonment and stuff. But even the rehabilitation method for prisoners is not accurate. So a lot of times, obviously, they do get rehabilitated and they come out and they're better for it. But a lot of times they don't. And especially in India, man, India's so messed up. Like life imprisonment, it's all corruption. You can get it down to 10, 7, 8. So I'm not saying that death penalty is the only other logical solution, but there is some middle ground. Obviously not taking a life, but rehabilitating.
So that was this week's episode of Film Feud. I hope you enjoyed the very frank discussion we had at the end. No pun intended for Frank Darabont. Yes. Nailed it.
You did nail it, as always. Let us know what you guys think and who you guys thought won that feud. You can tweet at us at Film Feud Pod and just let the people out there know that I annihilated Vidur.
Oh, sure, you annihilated me, just like you annihilate me every week when I win the poll. That's right, guys, we have a poll, and don't forget to answer it and make me win as always.
Vidur has delusions of grandeur, so let's see who wins this one. I'm pretty sure I will. So let's spin the wheel and figure out which movie we're feuding over next week.
Let's do it.
We got Dunkirk.
Were you imitating the soundtrack to Dunkirk right there?
Tick, tock, tick. No, I was not. It was just a reaction, a very neutral reaction.
We got Dunkirk, guys. Very low stakes.
Yeah. I mean, it's just Dunkirk.
Film to feud. Yeah, just Christopher Nolan's Dunkirk, number 112 on the list.
Dunkirk's actually pretty fresh in my mind. I remember both of us saw it for the first time together.
That's right. We watched it together in IMAX.
In IMAX, as it I feel like every IMAX movie should be seen in IMAX.
And what did you think of the movie, Vikram, in IMAX?
I'll reserve my opinion.
You too. Can't reserve your opinion because we watched it together and I was there to witness your opinion as you were to witness mine.
I've seen it maybe 3 or 4 times now. And
oh, I wonder why.
It's a Nolan movie, man. You just kind of have to. And since we do this semi-professionally, I feel like it's a responsibility.
It's our public service.
I know, right? Like, we need to make sure that we're on top of the game. But, I mean, the first time we saw it, it had an impact on
It was an experience.
It was an experience, no doubt.
I think we've skirted around the issue of not trying to reveal our feelings towards Dunkirk.
Yeah, let's not do it anymore, please.
The point is, guys, next week we are feuding Dunkirk. Look forward to that. And make sure you tweet at us for this week's feud. Let us know who you think won the feud for Green Mile. You can reach out to us, as always, on Twitter at FilmFeudPod. Or you can answer our poll at FilmFeud.com.
It's a formality at this point, and we already know who won this feud. So,
as always, the winner of the feud will be cinema.
So catch you guys next week.
Bye-bye.
See ya.